Hello. I'm Brokeass Stewart. You may know that already. I'm excited to be here. I get to see live comedy in person today. You get to see comedy on the screen, which is almost like being in person, but I'm really excited to be around people. And most importantly, I'm excited that you are here to help us pay broke comedians to be funny, and you're supporting independent journalism. You're doing a mitzvah by watching us be funny. This is fantastic. So thank you for being here. As you know, we're celebrating a weird thing. It is the COVIDversary. It's the COVIDversary. It's been a year. Like a year ago, March 16th, the world shut down. So naturally, by March 25th, my roommates started banging each other because it was COVID. Needless to say, we got a new roommate recently. But you know, it's also like the one year anniversary just about of when we all became obsessed with the Tiger King. And the thing that has really stuck with me about that, and I honestly think about this to this day, that I learned that every straight man only needs two tigers in a bag of meth, and they might end up in a gay redneck thruple. Yeah, I mean, I learned something about myself, honestly. So I want to give a huge shout out to Naked Kitchen for having us and sponsoring this in this beautiful space. When the world opens up, and it's happening soon, I'm optimistic. I'm going to try to get a shot. You're going to get a shot. We're going to get vaccinated. When the world opens up, have an event here. Support them. They do cool stuff. It's dope. You're going to have all kinds of cool events. And on top of that, I also want to thank my homegirl, Alex Liss, for putting this on. She is the magic and the glue that made all this happen. So thank you, Alex. Seriously. So tonight we have an incredible lineup of some of the funniest people in the Bay Area. Seriously, this is like a murderer's row of comics. So I'm just glad I get to see it. I'm glad you all get to see it too. So tonight, as you probably read, we have Ryan Levine, Chad Opitz, James Mara, Sureni Weerasekera, Murad Chaki, Emily Van Dyke, and Nadal Green. Make some noise for all the comics. All right, our first comic was born and raised here in the Bay Area. He's the creator of the hilarious sketch comedy series, Life of Trying, and produces the amazing show at Zeitgeist Beer Garden every Sunday. You may recognize him from Santa Barbara County Jail if you were there during that 1 week in 2013. Please welcome to the stage, Ryan Levine.
Yes, guys, give it up for Brokeass Stewart for throwing this whole thing. Yes. Hell yes. How cool is this? You can go. Get it. Yeah, get the fuck out of here. All right. Hell yeah. How cool is this show, though? I mean, like, yeah, how often do you get to see an art form die right before your eyes? That's special. This is special. How's quarantine going? Hell yeah, I say lock it back down. I was chilling at home, all right? No complaints. I was watching cooking reality shows every day. Chopped? I love Chopped. I love cooking reality shows. I love the verbal abuse that takes place on these shows. The contestants will put up with way too much shit. The host will be like, this souffle tastes like you should kill yourself. And they'll be like, thank you, chef. I've been getting experimental with my own cooking. I'm putting turmeric in everything. Not a lot, just enough to ruin it. I work from home. I just masturbate at home. That's all that means.
Me too.
Business is booming. We're considering going public. Say what you will about public masturbators. You have to respect that level of arrogance. Right? Like, who sees himself jerking off and thinks, you know who would love this? The bus. I got my vaccine. Anyone else get their vaccine?
Yeah.
You guys got your vaccine? No? Are you going to get it?
Probably.
Anyone questioning it?
A little bit.
A little bit? I don't judge you. I'm questioning it. People are like, you gotta trust the scientists. I'm like, I don't even know a scientist. If they're so trustworthy, where the fuck are they hiding, all right? I got questions. Who is Johnson? And who is Johnson, all right? I got a birthday coming up, I'm about to turn 26. Yeah, I got a week to catch coronavirus before I'm off my parents' health insurance. I'm squeezing every last dollar out of that thing. I got a CAT scan. The doctor was like, what exactly are you looking for? I was like, my money's worth. Thank you. That's an old joke. I'm 33. It still works. I'm not going to stop telling it. It didn't really the first 6 years. People were like, what the fuck is coronavirus? But now... Just kidding. Wrote it this morning. I'm 19. No, I'm an adult. I don't feel prepared for adulthood, though. I bought a briefcase. That felt appropriate. Turns out that's like the quickest way to learn that you don't have any important documents. So I've just been walking around with the eighth of weed and my birth certificate. I get high every day, right before I go to work. Not because I want to, but because I got high on the first day. So now for continuity purposes... I don't want them to think something's up. If I show up sober, they'd be like, wait a minute, why is this guy all of a sudden a terrific asset to this company? I do work with kids. You're correct. I used to think I wanted to work with kids until I started working with kids. Now I'm pretty sure I'd like to kill a kid. All right, that's extreme. I don't want to kill a kid. But say hypothetically, I stumbled across one dying, I might watch for a little while. I'd be like, I don't know what to tell you, Tristan. Maybe you should respect my authority a little more. I just moved into a new apartment. I live with three women, which roughly translates to about 90 succulents. A lot of succulents. I used to think living with women would make me a better person. Turns out I just pee sitting down now. I would stand, but there are literally succulents hanging from the ceiling. Yeah, you got succulents for sure, right? I bet your house looks like the house from Jumanji. You know what I mean? The one that turns into a rainforest. Any second, Robin Williams gonna pop out like, what year is it? What, did he die or something? Okay. Let's edit that part out. Hell yeah. One thing that's nice about quarantine, though, I'm getting closer with my dad, which is great. He's cool. I love him, and I depend on him financially, so it works out. My dad's weird. My dad leaves so many voicemails. He's way too stoked on the voicemail. And it's never, like, valuable information that he's leaving on the voicemails. It's only shit I have just directly on my phone. Just from looking at it, I know everything he's telling. He'll be like, hey, son, it's me, your dad. I'm calling you at 2:37 p.m. Pacific on Wednesday, June 3rd. The weather's fair, high of 73, low of 62. NASDAQ's up 6 points. Anyways, go ahead and give me a call back at 862-5204. Again, this is a real phone number, by the way. 510-862-5204. That joke crushed online. I promise you guys. At home, they are losing their shit right now. They're all calling my dad. All right. I'm on antibiotics, so drink for me. I can't drink. People freak out about antibiotics. They're like, you can't take antibiotics. It's going to cause the bacteria to mutate, which would render the antibiotics useless and would lead to the downfall of civilization. And I'm like, yeah, that still sounds better than having chlamydia right now. Are you kidding me? I'm Jewish. Any Jewish people here? All right. Oh, hell yeah. Stuart's Jewish. You're Jewish? Nice. I'm not the best Jew, though. I was in synagogue, and my rabbi asked me if I ever read the Torah. I was like, no, bro, I'm still working on the Prisoner of Azkaban. Just kidding. I didn't call my rabbi bro. Called him Baruch. That's what you call him. Hell yeah. My first job was at Wingstop. You know what my official job title was at Wingstop? It was Wing Specialist. What kind of patronizing shit is that? I'm not a specialist. Give me a better job title. How about the Wing King? I don't know. That's better. You're right. All right, I'm going to redo the joke with Wingman instead of. They didn't even give me a name tag. I had to make my own. It just said English major. Anyone else? Was anyone else English major? You were? Okay, my dad's disappointed in you as well. Yeah. Well, I've been lying. My dad's dead. So, just kidding. Just kidding. Give him a call, 862-5204. I don't like telling people I was an English major. They'll quiz me. They'll do that thing. They'll quiz me. They'll be like, oh, yeah, you were an English major. Well, did you read James Joyce? Or some other author? I'm like, no, I went to school to try to have sex. All right, leave me alone. I'm in a relationship. Sorry, ladies. It's an open relationship. Hello, ladies. I was excited about the open relationship at first. I was like, wow, I'm going to have a lot of sex. But now it's like, wow, she's having a lot of sex. And look, it is not a competition, but I am losing significantly, all right? No one is keeping score. It's 4-0. My girlfriend dates a very specific type of man. It's always like a fucking man. You know, like, yes, dude, like the leather jacket, like fucking like peeing standing up and shit. He's like a man, you know? Just a man, he's a DIY kind of guy, always, got tools and shit. I can tell if you've been up to something if I come home and there's a shelf installed. And I'm just not that guy, but that's all right. There's three types of men in this world. There's men who can fix things, there's men who pay other men to fix things, and there's men who let their girlfriends fuck men who can fix things. I'm not complaining, I depend on these guys. I told her, I was like, you better not screw things up with Alan, we got a big move coming up. I'm Orion Levine. Thank you guys so much for supporting live comedy. Enjoy the rest of the show.
Our next comic has been featured in SF Sketchfest and has been the winner of Jimmy Gunn's Best Newcomer Award. He's open for Michelle Wolf, Tom Green, and Bobcat Goldthwait. Wow. He was also a writer and actor in my 2019 web series, Shaky Ground. He's known for veering between one-liners, short story jokes, and sometimes even songs. Please welcome Chad Opens.
Hello, hey everybody, how are you? Good to be here, oh my God. Hopefully you're getting through this whole thing okay. This pandemic has changed the way I look at just about everything in my life. Like, I can no longer watch the Human Centipede series now without getting a little grossed out. You know, I was like, these people are gonna get sick. Oh my God. It used to be a fun romp. I'd watch that on Christmas with a family and shit. Whew. They are not social distancing. They're not 6 feet apart. They're practically 6 feet inside of each other. What the hell? This is Narnar. Lord. We got a lot of curveballs thrown at us last year. God damn. Like, did anyone hear the new Dance Club hit by actor Vin Diesel? Did anyone hear this? Called,
oh, yeah.
I Feel Like I Do. And I was like, oh my God, I gotta hear this piece of shit. I'm gonna hate this song. And I listened to that thing like 30 times. And I was like, oh my God, I got worried. I was like, do I like Vin Diesel's music? Or do I have COVID? Scared. I was like, I gotta get tested right away. Clean bill of health. I just have no taste. That's all it is. Goodness. My God. I do miss going to bars. I miss going out to bars and drinking. I don't miss spending money on drinks, though. Getting into comedy for the money is like getting into Dungeons and Dragons for the sex. It's not a good like money move. Like, cool that Naked Kitchen is putting this together, but I will never be able to afford to be here. The only Naked Kitchen I will ever know is my own kitchen at 2 a.m. making a Hot Pocket, okay? That's my Naked Kitchen. But I'd be at bars in the past. I'd want to get like a tasty drink. I'd want to get like a Sex on the Beach. I think that's a good cocktail, but I couldn't afford it. So I'd have to be the bartender for like a rim job on the bus. It's just a PBR with the edges licked by somebody with a cold sore. $1.50 comes with a free stick of Blistex. It's a bargain, baby! Yeah.
Oh my God.
Oh my goodness. Yeah, I do miss going to movie theaters too. I love going to movie theaters. God damn it. That's where I feel sexy. You know? Dim lights, smell of butter. That's my realm. You know, that's where I feel real hot. But can't go anymore, so I've been watching a lot of movies at home. I saw the trailer for the upcoming Top Gun sequel. I got all excited because I'm a fucking idiot, you know? I was like, oh my God, Tom Cruise is back, baby, just in time. He's America's best hope, age 63, right? Best we got. I love new Tom Cruise movies because now he insists on doing all of his own stunts and it's getting like Jackie Chan level crazy at this point where he's scaling skyscrapers with no wires. He's holding onto planes in midair. And I think it's because Tom Cruise finally realizes that death is the only way out of the Church of Scientology.
Yeah.
Like, there's no way out now, Katie! Get the fuck out of there. God. They make a fun musical discovery recently. I think I found the perfect song to play during a threesome.
All right.
Yeah, I think it's got to be Randy Newman's You Got a Friend in Me. Keep it light and playful. Perfect for any tryst, I'd say. Yeah. I'm trying to think of, like, extra ways to make money because the, you know, comedy thing has been, woohoo! No 401k with this shit. I was doing a little reading on like food from other cultures, right? That some countries eat donkey burgers, and I've never heard of that. I've never seen a donkey burger restaurant in the United States. I want to open up the first one, and I want to call it Ass to Mouth.
There you go.
It's gonna be next year's big Valentine's Day destination, Naked Kitchen. Yeah. Fuck yeah. Some people are not okay wearing masks in public. I'm totally cool with it because I talk to myself constantly, so I'm having like full monologues, just pretending nobody can hear me and shit. You know, I'm in the grocery store, just like whatever's playing. I'm just like,
if I could turn back time.
Someone's looking at me, and I'm like, that sounds like Cher to me. You think I would have that voice? Come on. No way. Not with this beard. Lord. There was a news story, not a news story, like early on in quarantine. It was like Adele. Sultry songstress Adele lost weight. Adele is hot now. And I was like, what the? Adele was already hot.
Yeah.
Adele's hot back then. Adele's hot now. I'll take Adele anyway I can get her, okay? I'm not going to complain about that sultry, talented woman.
That's right.
And I heard she might have a boyfriend now. I don't know if that's true or not. But if she's out there lonely and horned up in quarantine, I wrote a song for her to let her know I'm out there pining for her affections. And I know broke-ass Stewart has got a lot of pull. Okay, so if anybody can make it happen, it's old BAS. All right. Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much. All right. So this is my ditty for Adele, just to let her know I'm out there fighting for her affections under a tarp during this whole thing. So here we go. Oh, stretch.
Adele, I'm Chad. I got a sweet beard, look pretty good in the
yeah.
I wanna take you half of burritos and tea. So please go out with me. I'll buy you some curly fries. Wouldn't that be a sweet and savory surprise? And I want you to coagulate like a blood clot in my heart. And I won't even care during sex if you fall.
Yeah.
Let's make this dream come true. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Woo!
Yeah.
Yeah.
I just won a Grammy for that, so.
Yeah.
Have a wonderful evening. Thank you. Thank you.
Woo-hoo!
All right. Make some noise for Chad. And by the way, as these people, make sure to go follow them on Instagram and Twitter and stuff. They're all very funny people, and I stalk them all, honestly, myself, and you will not be disappointed by their funny antics online. Our next comedian, the son of a German mother and Kenyan father, raised in the South and a Bay Area resident since 2009. James has an unusual collection of experiences and perspectives from which to joke. On stage, he likes to discuss racial identity, dating, mental health, and the numerous ways that white people be tripping. Let's bring on James Mora.
Hello, hello. Is this working? Is it working? All right, it's good to be here. It's good to be making my television debut. It's also my rain debut. It's the first perform stand-up in the rain. And I don't know if you guys can see this at home, but sitting in the front row here are actually Mayor London Breed and former President Donald J. Trump. So it's actually really nice to be in front of such distinguished and esteemed guests. But I'm going to talk about me for a bit. I hope that's okay. My name is James. I am biracial. I'm half black, half regular. My mom's white. My dad's urban. I grew up in Georgia. I don't know if you guys have been there. I didn't really fit in Georgia because in Georgia there's really only black people and white people. There's very few ambiguously brown people like here in California, right? Like when I moved here, the first time I saw a Filipino, I was like, what the fuck is this? I was like, wait, so Asians have Mexicans too? Like I didn't realize there was two Mexicans. Didn't fit in growing up was a classic mixed kid dilemma. I'm sure you guys know what I'm gonna say. Too black for the white kids. Too big of a John Mayer fan for the black kids. So I was the only kid on the playground who used to get beat up and called the N-word and beat up for using the N-word. Like one time I got called the N-word by these rednecks. So I ran to my buddy Demarius, who was black, which is redundant. And I was like, yo, D, these fucking rednecks just call me a nigger. Let's go fuck them up. And he looked at me, and he was like, yo, what'd I tell you about that word? And he fucked me up. So that shit was pretty, it was pretty rough. I'm pretty racially ambiguous. You guys are like, this Puerto Rican dude's pretty funny. One of the reasons I know I'm ambiguous is because sometimes other races of people think that I'm their people, right? And that just leads to very awkward interactions, right? I recently got in an Uber. It was an Indian guy driving, obviously. Okay, just jokes, guys. And I knew someone was odd. He was being way too nice, you know? He called me brother. It was odd. Like, I get in the car, he's like, how's your day going, brother? Like, pretty good, brother. Like, how's your day going, man? Like, he's like, yeah, you live around here, brother? And I was like, yeah, brother, here where you pick me up. That's where I live. That's my house where I'm from. And he goes, and then he goes, hey, you want some of this scone I just got from Starbucks, my brother? At this point, I knew something was up, but I was hungry. I was like, brother, hook it up, dude, you know, like, let's do this. So now we're eating together, we're laughing, we're having a great time. And then he hits me with it. He's like, so, brother, what part of India are you from? Punjab? And I go, no, I'm actually not Indian. I'm actually black. And at that point, the energy changed in the Prius. Okay, it got really tense. He turns around. He goes, oh, I'm very sorry, sir. Yeah, my fucking pronouns got switched on me all of a sudden. And we just didn't talk for the rest of the ride. I have a girlfriend. Sorry, boys. I do have a girlfriend. Anyone else here start a relationship during quarantine? Has anyone else like started dating someone during quarantine? Yeah, that shit fast tracks the relationship, okay? Sometimes they're like, who is this bitch? this is how crazy it was. At one point last year, me and my girlfriend went from fucking other people to being exclusive, to being boyfriend, girlfriend, to breaking up, to getting back together, to farting in front of each other. In exactly 25 days, okay? It happened in 25 days last March. So I feel like at this current rate, by the end of quarantine, she's gonna be pregnant, and I'm gonna be gone, dude. Like, I'm gonna be, starting a new family. I asked her to do anal the other day. You guys ever do anal? I know you guys saw it. Mayor London Breed is huge into anal. Anal's cool, man. It's kind of a tough question. You gotta ask, right? It's tough, man. It's like you want to be romantic, but it's like at the end of the day, I'm like, I'm trying to fuck your ass. You know what I mean? So I asked her. I was like, I just manned up, right? I G'd up. I was like, hey, baby, let's, you know, let me fuck your butt, right? And then. And she goes, James, I don't want to have anal because your dick is too thick and it's going to hurt. When I heard that, I was so happy. I just came right then and there, so I didn't even need sex. And then a few days after that, I was actually peeing, which one does. And I was looking at my penis, and I was like, it's not that thick. I had a bit of a eureka moment, you know what I mean? So I confronted her. I was like, baby, do you really think my dick is too thick to have anal? And she goes, listen, I just don't have anal, okay? So she tricked me. So the next time we were having regular sex, she was like, I love your dick. And I was like, you're a fucking liar. I'm black and I have severe mental health issues. Relatable. And being black and having mental health issues is pretty tough because there's still a lot of stigmas in the black community about mental health, right? Like, we don't really talk about it. It's a problem, right? So the other day I switched my meds. I went from Wellbutrin to Lexapro. And I ran straight to my white friends, okay? Directly to my allies, you know? And they were very supportive, like, oh my God, we are so happy for you, you know? Have you tried CBD? Oh, it really helps, right? Like, they were very supportive. And then one of my black friends walked in, hear what we were talking about, and he goes, yo, you ever tried Triactin? And I was like, no, what's that? And he was like, Triactin like a real nigga. And I was like, yo, you know what, actually? All right, that's been it for me, guys. Thank you so much. Give it up one more time for Mayor London Breed and former President Donald J. Trump. Thank you guys very much. All right.
Our next comedian is Sri Lankan-born, San Diego-raised, and San Francisco-based stand-up comedian, actor, and writer. She recently opened for Comedy Central's roast battle champion, Frank Castillo. Please welcome Sureni Weerasekera.
Thank you so much. You guys don't know it at home, but that was actually his 56th try getting my name right. So, all right. And okay, yeah, you're definitely the one who likes anal, right? Okay, just making sure. I'm stoked to be here. This is cool. This is fucking cool. We got confident guy in leather, you know, just went to a black barber. Hey, I like this. This is great. Thank you so much. And right there, yeah, that looks like some San Francisco intel watching from home. All right, thank you so much. A little bit about me. I am bisexual, and it took me a while to figure it out because every time I hooked up with a woman, I only did it when I was drunk. Next day, couldn't remember if I liked it or right. Did that for a year. Figured out I was an alcoholic before I was gay. All right, and then I started going on sober dates, and I got even more confused. I was like, am I into women or empathy? You know what I mean? Like, do I like boobs or feeling understood? Okay. Now I'm living out the pandemic with my lady. Oh shit. Okay. And rain's picking up. Okay. Was that hail too? Okay. I've been living out the pandemic with my lady. And when you spend so much time with someone, you start to notice some shortcomings. You know what I mean? For example, she's got a really high libido, and I've got a really low one. Right. So it's not really shortcomings as it is shorted of cummings. But she's got a really high one. You know what I mean? So I'm trying to up mine. I'm eating aphrodisiacs like chocolates, strawberries. She's trying to meet me halfway, so she's eating Xanax. And if that ain't love, then I don't fucking want it, okay? And we've been cooking a lot, which is nice. You know, I'm bringing in a lot of South Asian spices into the mix. She's bringing in a lot of Mexican spices. Like, we good at our house. You know what I mean? Like, when we take a shit, we burn incense, okay? Just works different. The turmeric and the cumin. And we've been thinking about van life recently. You know, it's more economical. And we're looking up hashtag van life for inspiration as to where we're going to put all these, you know, 8 cabinets worth of spices. And there's one common factor among all these people. Okay, stay with me, guys. It's all white people. Okay? Because you only need a little room for salt. You know what I mean? Like, your whole spice cabinet is your car cup holder. Do you know what I mean? Okay, maybe that's a little mean. That's a little white people be like. Obviously, white people got a variety of spices, you know what I mean? Like, they got sea salt, Himalayan salt, cocaine. Just a wide variety of spices. We have been gaining weight, my girlfriend and I will say. And I feel like from the right angle, we just look like two pregnant women supporting each other, you know? We'll get through, you know. I remember we were making out one day, and I grabbed her titty, and she's like, "What are you doing?" I'm like, "I'm touching your titty," and she's like, "That's not my titty." I was like, "What is it?" She's like, "That's my fat roll," and I was like, "Is it wrong that I prefer it?" Okay. I was like, "Your titties got bigger." Oh. I swear, I'm a feminist. Okay, big fan of the equality. But sometimes I feel like I'm part of the problem. Okay, because I swipe on men and women, and I've noticed every time I match with a woman, I'm like, what do I say to see your titties? But I match with a guy, I'm like, I wonder where he grew up. With a woman, it's like, ah, she looks so soft and squishy. Is he close with his dad? I just want to smell you! Like, what is that? What is that guttural response, right? Like, I feel like it's better for me to call myself a feminist in progress. Like, I'm still trying to undo the reflex where I think all cats are girls and all dogs are boys. Every time I see two cats having sex, I'm like, love wins. I'm trying to ask better questions, okay? I'm trying to ask better questions, questions with depth. Okay, like, hi, ma'am, I think you're very pretty, okay? I like the earrings, you know what I mean? That's, I feel, it, plants, oh, hell yeah. Are you another person compensating plants for personality? Is that, okay, because I do that too. And it does fill the void a little bit, but... what's something you're passionate about?
Oh, gosh. Travel.
Travel. Not doing a lot of that. Travel. Cool. Cool. Can I see your tits? Okay, one of these days, man, it's going to work. Not today. One tit? Okay, moving on. Moving on. We'll check back, okay? Let's see. Fucking... My girlfriend, no, I do really love how sex positive she is, you know, like we got this toy together, we got this thing called the Nexus, okay, and it's one of these sex toys where it goes inside of me so I can go inside of her, mm-hmm. You know what I mean, like I get fucked while fucking her, I don't have a dick, she doesn't have a dick, that's 2021 technology, okay, and the best fucking part about it, the best fucking part is if we ever break up, we just cut it in half and we both get a dildo, okay, that is economical, got it on Black Friday, coupon involved, okay, fuck getting a prenup, dude, fuck a prenup. Just buy things you can cut in half. You got a tandem bike together if we ever break up, boom, two unicycles. You got a pair of socks together if we ever break up, boom, two Muppets, okay? We got a cat together if we ever break up. She can keep the cat, I'll take her other dildo, you know what I mean? hell yes, fuck it, let's go, baby. I feel alive. I don't miss the swiping, though, because I feel like, you know, Tinder, like, it has its own language, right? Like, in the bios. Like, I skateboard is code for I'm going to give you a UTI. All right? Or, for example, the name Rusty is code for I skateboard, okay? People give me shit because I have dated a skateboarder, okay? But he's also a business owner. What does he sell? Weed. you know, it's interchangeable, that punchline. Skateboards works, too. Fucking, I feel like you're growing as a comedy writer by the end of the show. You're gonna be headlining this bad shit. I'm really happy that my parents, they came from Sri Lanka for my brother and I to have a better life. You know, this is the land of opportunity, you know? And are you guys familiar with the concept of Maslow's hierarchy of needs?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, some of you are, some not. It's basically, it outlines your most basic needs to your most complex, right? First it's food and water, then it's shelter, then it's emotional connections and self-actualization, right? My parents, they always had to worry about the first two, food and water, you know what I mean? And then shelter. And when they got that from my brother and I, they're like, we fucking made it, you know what I mean? They're bumping fanny packs together, like, we fucking did this shit, you know? And thanks to them, like, I've always known that, you know what I mean? So I'm looking to the next thing. Like, they don't understand that I need to go to Coachella to find myself, you know what I mean? Like, let me do this ayahuasca and Joshua tree, please, you know? It's just a cultural disconnect. What was that? Still fanny packs, though. Yeah, it's come back around now, you know? Now I'm wearing fucking high-waisted jeans. I'm part of the problem, you know? The last thing I will say is I was working as a barista before all the shit hit the fan. I remember somebody walked into my cafe, and they did one of the most piece of shit things. They walked into my cafe, and they stole some tips out of the tip jar. Yeah, and my coworker, she was like, you know, if he's stealing tips, like, he needs it more than I do. But I've been stealing her tips. Because clearly I need it more. Okay, my name is Ray. Thank you so much. Keep it going for your house. Thank you.
All right. You all having fun? You people at home, are you laughing? I can tell you're laughing. The camera's jiggling. I can tell you're giggling. All right. So our next comedian runs shows all over the Bay Area under Dope Show Comedy. You might have seen him at SF Sketch Fest or the Oakland Comedy Festival. Everybody, please make some... I can't read. Our next comedian runs shows all over the Bay Area under Dope Show Comedy. You might have seen him at SF Sketch Fest or the Oakland Comedy Festival. Everybody, please make it nice and loud for Murad Shaki. Yeah!
Hey guys, welcome to our weekly GameStop shareholders meeting. Glad you all could come, power to the players. I definitely put in that intro for Stuart to say he brings diversity right before I come up, so I think Stuart bailed on that one.
Maybe she put that in there.
Oh, cool. All right, so my set's a dialogue now. That's cool. Anyway, guys, hi. My name's Murad. It's a weird name, I know. It goes with a weird look. In Arabic, it means wished for. And at the airport, it means randomly selected. Seems like a sweet thing to name your kid, right? Wished for, that's so nice. Only I just found out that I beat my mom's IUD. So you're looking at the real 1% here, ladies and gentlemen. That's why it's weird she'd name me Murad, right? Wished for? Clearly not. She should have named me something Arabic that means fine, I guess. We'll take him. I just came out of the womb holding that shit like a trophy. Like, you tried to stop me, bitch. I got out. Well, no, not really. I did not call my mom a bitch fresh out of... That would have been pretty impressive, honestly. I know the way I look confuses people. I get a lot of misplaced racism as a result because people can't figure out just quite how to hate me, you know? Like, I was in L.A. recently. I was sipping a cup of coffee. I passed by this woman. She whispers to me, "Little Jew likes his Starbucks." I was like, "Hey, lady, you didn't have to call me little, okay? That was really uncalled for." I know I'm like very racially ambiguous. People can't place me. Like, I remember back in high school, we had a CIA recruiter stop by. He singles me out and says, "See, we'd recruit somebody like you because we could stick you anywhere. Brazil, Egypt, Middle Earth, Atlantis. It doesn't really matter." A lot of people ask me if I'm black, though. What do you think, ma'am? Decide right now. Decide my race right now. Decide my race. Go decide. Wow, you just waved your hands. That's not a race. Usually people just panic and say mix, and I'm like, of what, herbs and spices? Be specific. But a lot of people ask me if I'm black, and the conversation always goes the same way. It's, "Hey man, are you black?" "Well, I'm Egyptian." "Oh, so you're African." "Yeah, so you're black." "Well..." And that's how that conversation goes. Every single time, because here's the thing, I'm North African. That sounds kind of black. But on the other hand, white people had to start somewhere, right? We're all from Africa. Maybe I'm just like the Model T Ford of honkies. I'm how y'all used to look, just the first iPod of white people, the prototype. I'm sorry, you guys are my closest reference point. Also, Egypt is right up there by Greece, and Greek food is just Arab food with too much fucking yogurt on it anyway. So you see the identity confusion? So annoying, too. People, they can't really racially place me. They'll call me a person of color. We're all familiar with this term, right? It's woke, but I'm not sure why. Because it feels like white people just figured out how to say colored again, you know? Sneaky dub. They just added some extra syllables to it. I don't know what problem that solves. They'd be like, "Hey man, did you hear about those terrorists?" "Whoa, whoa, buddy. People of terror, okay? Let's be respectful." Are you guys having like a slightly less depressing year than last year? Is it a little better, 2021 for you? Is it a little better? Okay, a lot of bummed out people in this kitchen. I started my year strong on January 1st. I got COVID. Hell yeah, guys. Mother Nature's vaccine. That's what I called it. I got exposed on the 1st, got tested on the 2nd, didn't get any results till the 6th. don't know if you guys know, but some shit went down on the 6th. I was watching a live stream of some very angry people outside the Capitol building. Just a bunch of chubby white people in face paint and costumes. Looked like a racist Comic-Con. And right as they break into the Capitol building, my phone buzzes twice and my doctor's like, hey, maybe don't go outside for 2 weeks. So, new year, new me. I will say, though, showing proof you have antibodies is a great way to drive engagement on your Tinder. That's what I found out. Getting a bunch of matches now. I don't even think it has anything to do with me. I think girls are just like, whatever, dude, any warm body that won't give me the plague, I'm down. So I've just been going through, like, old matches with white girls that have ghosted me. And I'm like, hey, I didn't see you at the Capitol building. I thought we were supposed to meet up. So now I'm on several lists. So it's been a very stressful time. I don't think that's like a hot take. I know things aren't really going well for me because my therapist keeps ending all of our sessions by saying, hang in there, man. Which, I don't know, dude, you used to give me real advice. Like, I could just buy a motivational poster of a little kitten hanging from a tree branch. I didn't have to do this copay. And then he wrote me a prescription to keep on trucking. So that's how things are going for me. Ooh, too sad, boy. Okay. Don't worry, it gets worse. I haven't been coping with my quarantine very well. I've eaten a 4-pack of Reese's Cups every single day since it started. I don't even taste them anymore. And you know, they say there's no wrong way to eat a Reese's, but have they tried the fetal position? You have to eat them real quick in the shower. That's all I'm trying to say. Okay, I can work with booze, not Oz, you know what I mean? I think you can tell how stressed out people are right now by the forms of entertainment that have really gained popularity recently. Like, I feel like to unwind, everybody's just watching, like, videos of cake baking and ASMR. Do you know what ASMR is? It's just long videos of good sounds. Like, we don't even need stories to unwind anymore. Just like, ugh. I had a bad day at work. Could somebody please put a microphone by a kitten eating dry food or... maybe by like a cute Asian lady stepping on bubble wrap? Barefoot, I am a freak. Like, one popular ASMR video will have like 4 million views. That's the margin by which Biden won the presidency. Is just one lit video of like a Shiba Inu eating popcorn. That was the difference maker. Are we happy that the mean guy lost the president contest? Are we happy about that? Okay, cool. Couple Republicans in the back, that's good to know. Hot take. I think these Republicans are kind of mean. I should know, I dated one. She worked for the GOP. That's a true story. But I was kind of into that because I'm a dirty little immigrant boy and I need to be punished, you know? Just lock me up in a cage. Throw away the key. I love it. Okay, too real. That's good. As you might be able to tell from my set, I'm generally fucking crushing it in life right now. Mean laughs. I had to get a colonoscopy recently. Yeah, that was an appropriate muted response of sympathy. Thank you. Colonoscopy prep is super brutal. It's a 24-hour clear liquid fast. You can't have any solids. You can only have Jell-O. And I didn't have any Jell-O because I'm not a fucking mom from the 40s. So I go to Safeway, try and find some Jell-O. Can't find it. Go to an employee. I'm like, dog, where's the Jell-O? To which he responded, oh, Jell-O? Like, for Jell-O shots? That's a weird first association to make with Jell-O, right? That'd be like, oh, you need lotion? Like, for jacking off? Oh, you need a belt? Like, to beat your kids with? Oh, you need diapers? Like, for jacking off? It's a kinky Safeway employee, ma'am. Don't yuck his yum. It's 2021. That's his love language, okay? I was pretty nervous heading into the procedure because I was there to find out if I had colon cancer or not. Wow, it is pouring rain on me. This microphone is shocking my lips. This is definitely how I saw my comedy career going a year ago. This is what the psychic told me. What was I talking about? Butt stuff. Okay, cool. I was pretty nervous because I was there to find out if I had colon cancer or not. Don't worry, I don't. Didn't know it at the time, though. Was comforted when I walked into the procedure room. Saw the tiny little camera they shove up your butt. I don't know why I was expecting like a GoPro or a DSLR. Maybe somebody's webcam they shoved right up there. But what did not comfort me was the weird Russian doctor I had who felt the need to emphasize to me that I was the youngest person he'd ever given a colonoscopy to. I don't know why he had to bestow that honor upon me. I don't think I got a fucking student discount or anything. And he proved I was the youngest person getting a colonoscopy that day by showing me the full list of everybody getting butt stuff done to them that day. He goes, look, patients, 60, 70, 80 years old, then you, 25. I am Russian, no data is private. Oh, come on, that's a woke joke. You can be xenophobic to Russians, nobody cares. Also, he wasn't Russian, he was Chinese, but I can't do that accent on stage. Now can I? Anyway, guys, my name is Murad Shaki. If you like me, you should follow me on Instagram at Murad Shaki. That's M-U-R-A-H-D. If you follow me on Instagram, you get the OnlyFans discount code. So make sure you hop to it. Supplies unlimited. Anyway, thank you.
Our next comedian is originally from the Midwest. She loves best friend tattoos and telling inappropriate jokes at baby showers. Emily is open for Colin Quinn and Judah Friedlander, and she's performed at SF Sketchfest. She's a local favorite in the Bay Area. Make some noise for Emily Van Dyke.
We're here. Am I on? Is it working?
Yeah.
Just 1 year ago, we were all thinking this would be over in 4 weeks. So beautiful. My name's Emily Van Dyke. It's been a very challenging name. It's a Dutch name. It translates to of the dyke. I used to teach high school here in San Francisco, and my students had to call me Miss Van Dyke, and they hated that because they had learned in their anti-bullying curriculum that the word dyke is offensive. So they would just shorten it to Miss VD. And I was like, please don't call me that. And they're like, why? It's short for Van Dyke. I'm like, it's short for venereal disease. But they didn't know what venereal disease was because they weren't born in the last century like we all were, you know? They're from the 2020s. And it's, you know, it's hard to explain VD to 16-year-olds, you know, because it's not their thing. Plus, it's rebranded so many times. It used to be VD, and then it became STDs. Around my time, and then it became STIs, and then recently it became no big deal. So I think that's one perk of COVID. I don't even know if there's STDs anymore. I feel like it's been squashed from inactivity. That's good. I'm really starting to like get used to the whole COVID situation. I like everybody's mask style, you know? You can really tell a lot about a person's mask. It's been really beautiful. My favorite mask situation that's happening right now is the dude that has like the full-on beard that goes from like his cheekbones down to his neck hair. And then he's got like a little tiny like white cotton mask that's just barely covering his nose and mouth. Like a small pair of panties. With just massive hair coming out the side like a girl who showed up to a hot tub party not ready. It's a lot to think about at the grocery outlet. So as comedians, we've been doing different types of shows all year, you know, we've been doing these Zoom shows and it's been weird, you know, out in patios, we've been getting heckled by guys on bikes, dogs barking, garbage trucks, and then we've been on Zoom after working on Zoom. It's been a lot. One thing I've learned about myself while being on Zoom is that I have thin lips. I did this whole time I've been alive, 37 years, I never knew I had thin lips until I had to look at myself, smile like a freaking jack-o'-lantern. And I was like, no one's ever said anything. Like my friends are the fakest friends of all time. I've been walking around basically with my pants unzipped this whole time. No one's ever said, hey, have you ever thought about getting some lips or doing some sort of lip liner? Like, literally the only person listening to me is my Instagram feed, who after this show will be like, hey, we've got a Groupon for you. It's been a lot. So, I don't know. I'm stuck at home, working from home. I clearly have gotten into buying pajamas that look like work clothes. That's my new big investment. I can take these earrings off and switch into some sweatpants, and this is my outfit for the rest of the week. So, it's pretty good. But yeah, I'm stuck at home with my kid. She's almost two. She's great, but she says mama like 1,000 times in 1,000 different ways. She'll be like, mama, 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 mama. And I'm like, yes, baby, just trying to be patient, you know, because you're not supposed to flip. But she says mama like 1,000 times. And what I want to say is, say mama one more time. See what happens. I'm like, this is why parents leave for cigarettes and never come back. Because you've said mama 4 billion times and I've burned the whole house down. I'm married to a Cuban that I brought from Cuba on a 90-day fiancé visa. So, I don't know, catch us on Hulu. It's good. It was a lot of paperwork. I don't know if you watched that show, but it's a lot of work. And I would do it again. I would rather bring a Spanish-speaking socialist through Trump's immigration system than try to make a husband from a San Francisco Bumble date. That's not the story that I'm going to be telling my grandkids. Nope, that's not it. So yeah, I tried to find like a person here like right around the corner for many years, but if you live in San Francisco, you know it's garbage. This place is garbage for men. There's a lot of like, you know, there's not a lot of dad material in San Francisco. There's a lot of like little brothers, you know, and some Peter Pan type dudes. But there's not a lot of like real serious dudes. I mean, you saw the lineup tonight. Can you imagine? Can you imagine locking that down as the father of your future kids? Can you imagine broke-ass Stuart being your dad? I mean, his name is broke-ass Stuart. Like, do you just call him, like, daddy broke-ass or broke-ass daddy? I'm not really sure how it would work, so. It's a lot, so I had to leave the country. It was fine, though. It's good. I think my turning point was when I got spooned by a data scientist. Like Stuart said, I'm from the Midwest, so I'm a sturdy medium, you know? I was raised on whole milk and shutting up about my feelings. And then to be spooned by a data scientist makes you feel very unsafe. It's like being held by like a shaky koala with just little tiny hands. And it's like, why can I feel your heartbeat through my back? Stop trying to sell my data from my bed, dude. You are scary, all right? So crazy. I dated this data scientist one time, and the last night I stayed over there, the rain stopped for the beautiful story of my turning point. I stayed over there, and somebody tried to break into his apartment. So we were sleeping there, and I hear the window smash, and I go, babe! And he goes, mom! And I was like... That's it. It's a wrap. I'm by myself. So it's crazy. But now, yeah, no, my husband, we speak Spanish in my marriage, which is really funny because I have a minor in Spanish from Ball State University in Indiana. And, you know, the Midwest is not known for their multicultural programs. So my Spanish is at like a level like eighth grade, maybe. It's getting better. But, you know, did you guys ever learn Spanish and then forget it immediately? Yeah. They teach you all those, like, ridiculously useful phrases, like, ¿Dónde está la biblioteca? Like, the biblioteca was never popping. Like, you're never going to get to a Spanish-speaking country and be like, ¿Dónde está la biblioteca? I'm just trying to get oriented here. Oh, yeah, it is fun being in a multilingual marriage, because when I talk really fast in English and when he talks really fast in Spanish, we have no clue what the other person is saying. So when we fight, we can get like a good rough draft out. Like, I can just like unleash the anger and he has no clue what I'm saying. And I'm just like, oh my gosh, this is horrible. Like, we have nothing in common. Like, we don't even speak the same language. We don't even have the same religion, the same economy. We don't have the same, we don't have the same anything. You know, like, we'll never understand each other. This was doomed from the beginning. And he's like, what are you saying? And I'm like, what I'm saying is, if we focus on our similarities, I think we can work through any obstacle. And that's how you stay married during COVID. It's very challenging. It's very challenging, but I don't know, having this kid is good, you know? Whew, I barely squeaked in there, you know, I'm in my late 30s. San Francisco will just keep you young forever just forgetting about all your goals, you know what I'm saying? Like, you will literally, like, fall asleep at a beer garden and wake up at Dolores Park and be like, damn it, I forgot to have a family. I just have two cats and I'm the cool aunt, you know? This is not what I was planning. So, it's crazy, I'm glad, but I don't know, being pregnant's weird, you know, and nobody really has kids around here, so they don't really talk about it, you know. When you see a pregnant person walking by, you're like, oh, that's so cute, you know, but it's crazy. Like, when you're pregnant, it's like you're your regular self, but then there's, like, something gaining force and momentum inside of you. It's like being haunted from the inside out. There's, like, a spirit, like, gaining, sucking your, it's crazy, you know? And then all of a sudden, like, 6 months, 7 months, you start to feel, like, kicks inside of there. You're like, ah, what's going on? Like, you'll be sleeping in the middle of the night, you feel this, like, roundhouse kick. And I turn over to my husband, like, did you feel that? And he's like, I don't know what you're talking about. And I'm like, this is it, I'm in it by myself. And then my baby calls, and she's like, I'm inside the house. And I got pregnant the week that I got married, which was weird. I forgot to plan the birth control situation in the midst of all the wedding stuff. But it's cool. When you get surprise pregnant, you also get surprise sober, which I never thought about that. You know, it's not like one day you're living your full life, you know, and you're having a great time, and then the next day you're like, oh, okay, cool. So just shut it down, you know, like all the things I like to do, sushi, blue cheese, you know, smoking weed, everything, just that's it. All right, it's over then. So I don't know. It's crazy. So to be honest with you, I took the pregnancy test and I was like, I'm pregnant. I'm going to go tell somebody. And then I was like, or should I just pocket this for the weekend? You know, no one really needs to know. And then it's so weird when you get pregnant and you're like deep into your 30s and married, like not one of my friends called me and was like, what are you going to do? You know, like they all were just like, you're going to have it. And I was like, where are my rights? You know, like I don't get any choices around here. So it was crazy. But, you know, now I'm doing the thing. And we're just trying to stay married, which is good. I saw on the news this lady stabbed her husband because he had eaten all the salsa. She stabbed him in the groin, which is a very passionate place to stab a man. I think it was more of a threat, you know? Like, she didn't get him right in the good stuff. She was like, I'm just close, you know? And I was reading the whole story, and I thought, like, this is weird, you know? Like, this is a little extreme. But then I thought, I can see how it happens. You know, because grocery shopping has been so stressful, you know? And so you go out grocery shopping, you get everything, you get it all wiped down, you know, you throw your mask in the washer, you're getting everything, you put some chips and salsa out for your dude, you're like, I'm gonna make some celebration margaritas, I'll be right back. Go get your margaritas, you come back, you got a movie in mind, this dude is eating all the salsa! Like, dude, I can't. And it's not even about that salsa from that day, it's about all the salsa he's eaten up until that point. Like, this is just the salsa that broke the salsa's back, you know? And the very similar thing happened to me. I went to go get some takeout for my husband, and I brought home his dish that he ordered, my dish that I ordered, and I bought myself some truffle macaroni and cheese. Oh, and I got home, and he was unpacking everything. He's like, ooh, macaroni and cheese, who's this for? And I was like, well, it was for me, but since we're married, I guess it's for us, because that's what you do when you get married. You just give up everything that you love. And so I got out the macaroni and cheese, and I took a Sharpie, and I drew a line around the container, and I put my name, Emily, is this bottom half, and my husband's name is this, and I was like, listen, this is you at the top, all right, because I know you, te conosco. I know you're going to eat my macaroni and cheese, so don't dip below the line. He's like, all right, this is very strict. So we're having a nice dinner, and then halfway through, he grabs the big spoon and the macaroni and cheese, and he's listening to me, and he straight up starts spooning my macaroni and cheese onto his plate, and I was like, you're about to lose your life right now. I was like, I clearly set up the parameters of the macaroni and cheese, and now you're not even respecting my boundaries. And I lost it, and he was like, what are you going to do? You're going to physically stop me from getting the macaroni and cheese? And I was like, I don't know what's going to happen, dude. And so he scoops out almost the whole thing onto his plate, and he goes to take a bite, and I stood up, and with my bare hand, I grabbed the macaroni and cheese off of his plate, and I put it onto my plate, and I turned around and walked to the bedroom and ate the whole dinner in bed under the covers. I felt so proud of myself, because this is how you prevent domestic violence. I was just like, you did such a good job right there. You de-escalated that situation. You walked away, and that's what you're supposed to do. And so after I finished my plate, I walked back to the kitchen, and I was like, yo, people are getting stabbed for this type of stuff. All right? And that was when COVID was really bad, and there was, like, no ICU beds. I was like, you could be sitting in the parking lot of a Kaiser in South City because you did not respect my macaroni and cheese boundaries. Explaining that in Spanish, so that'd be horrible. But everybody stay merry. Thank you guys so much for supporting comedy. My name's Emily Van Dyke.
Yeah, the only fight me and my wife got into over this one thing was over green apples. You know, there's this one moment you're just like, I brought home the wrong apples, and I guess it's a thing now. Yeah, COVID's crazy. When you spend 24 hours a day with someone, and you're like, we don't even have sex, we just fight over apples now, you know? All right, our last comedian of the night. I actually do read, and I write too. Our last comedian of the night appeared in the movie Sorry to Bother You. He's a regular on the Bugle podcast, and he's the country's only semi-functional hybrid of comedian and union organizer. Please welcome Nate O'Green.
Hey everybody, it's 1 year since lockdown, and this is the first time that I've spoken in public in a year. So,
thank you for being here.
We'll see how that goes. I don't have an act, but I've prepared 9 jokes for you. And I say that I'm going to count them off as I go, so that it's super weird on the video when Alex edits one out. Number one, I think we can all agree that the tech people are inventing the wrong stuff. They're not inventing the things that we need. You know what I mean? Like now, you know, we have wildfires in Northern California, and I'm terrified about wildfires, something new for me to be afraid of. Fire cyclones, where there's fires that go fucking 200 miles an hour. It's like, hey, tech people, could you maybe fucking invent something that will stop the fire cyclone? And they're like, no, we're busy. We're inventing Shazam for soup. You don't know. You could have a gazpacho or a bisque or a chowder. You don't know. You need an app. Like, no, motherfuckers, you're not helping. Hey, tech people, the IPCC climate report says that we only have 11 years to reduce carbon emissions enough to avert the catastrophic collapse of civilization. Could you maybe invent something to suck the carbon out of the sky? And the tech people are like, no, we're busy. We're inventing Uber for Uber. So, like, if you don't have an Uber, you can see who around you has an Uber, and then get that guy to call you an Uber. So we do that first, and then we'll suck the carbon out of the sky. All right. Number two. It was my birthday this week. Thank you, everybody. And as we all know, if you are a man and a dad in your 40s, and it's your birthday and it's pandemic, what do you get? Alcohol. You get a lot of alcohol-related gifts. If you had asked me 15 years ago, I would never have predicted this, but I've just accepted that this is who I am now. Like, do I need to have, you know, absinthe and cardamomo around the house? Apparently I do. Like, when you hit your 40s, you start wrestling with significant questions, like, how many different kinds of vermouth do I need to have? Apparently the answer is 3. So that's what I'm dealing with. All right? Number 3. Back to politics. The Democrats passed the COVID relief bill. Very exciting. It's a good bill. Like, I'm having a hard time, like, processing it, and there's a lot of good news in it. Republican House Leader Kevin McCarthy went on the news and he said, this is unacceptable, this is not a relief bill, this is a laundry list of left-wing ideas. And my main problem with his comment is that it reveals that clearly he does not understand how laundry is done, because most of us do not do our laundry in list form. Like, today it sucks. I think what he meant to say is it's a bridal registry of left-wing ideas, which I'm all about. Number four, 8 Democrats. There was a proposal in the bill to raise the minimum wage to $15 an hour. It's a hugely popular and necessary piece of public policy, supported by 60% of voters, by 85% of Democratic voters, and 8 Democrats who previously supported raising the minimum wage now voted against it in the stimulus bill. Clearly, because it's so popular, they voted against it because it was too popular. They're like, sorry, we used to be into it, and now everybody's into it, and now we're against it. It's like, motherfucking Democrats, this is not Imagine Dragons. So, you're not that cool. Number five. Look, I hate Joe Biden just on principle because I hate politicians. Like, fuck them all, you know what I mean? Like, I don't care what they've done. Like, why haven't you abolished all prisons yet? You know what I mean? Like, that's sort of how I come out of the gate. But I'm also like, it's exciting, you know, like it's like I'm feeling a sense of hope. It's just a relief, you know, to like have this sense of like no, it's been 2 months and no reporters had to say like in a flurry of 5 a.m. tweets attacking his enemies. You know what I mean? Like, that's just refreshing. Like it's a sense, just a sense of calm. Do you know what I mean? Like a sense of relief. Like do you ever have that feeling where like there's some annoying sound and then the sound turns off and you realize you've had a headache for 5 years and you like are overcome with peace and tranquility. It's a weird feeling. Biden said that it's a national emergency, that COVID is a national emergency and it's time we treated it like one. And when he said national emergency, it was refreshing that he was talking about COVID and not women having ideas. So, all right, okay, we'll see. Number six, one thing that I'm looking forward to the end of with the end of the Trump years is people saying dumpster fire. I'm fucking sick of that expression. Everybody's calling everything a dumpster fire, and I hate the expression because it's wrong as a metaphor. It's incorrect. Because when dumpster fire is garbage, which is something that you don't want, on fire in a contained space. That is a good thing. If you had to pick between a dumpster fire and a child care center fire, dumpster fire 100% of the time. Number seven, the vaccines are out. People are divided about it. Some people are worried about the vaccines. They're like, oh, I don't know. It's a vaccine. It's like, maybe my arm will hurt for a day or I'll have a horrific death alone. Like, I don't know. It's hard to, I saw a video on YouTube of a barista with an opinion. So let me get into it. So there's multiple vaccines. Like there's the Pfizer vaccine, which is a 2-shot vaccine, the Moderna vaccine, which is a 2-shot vaccine, and the Johnson & Johnson, which is a 1-shot vaccine, and I think that's confusing. It should be the Johnson and the Pfizer and Pfizer, so that you can remember how the shots are in the name. Please pair that joke with Orion's joke about Johnson & Johnson. Anyway, and people are like being shitty about the vaccines. People who don't know anything about science are suddenly acting like they're like vaccine connoisseurs. They're like, no, I'm gonna wait until I can get the AstraZeneca or whatever the fuck, because I read an Israeli study about the efficacy of the vaccine. Like, no, none of us know what we're talking about.
Thank you.
Do what the doctor says. You're welcome. But it's such a pain in the ass to get the vaccines. I feel like getting the vaccines is like getting to a rave in the 90s. Like, kids. Back in the, like, if you, we wanted to go to rave, like, now you just go online, you get it, it's a thing. Back in the day, like, to go to a rave in the 90s, you would, like, have to go to a payphone and call a guy and give someone a cigarette, then you'd go to another location and page someone, and you'd have to bring a case of Jolt Cola, even though it had been discontinued, and then you'd, like, drive 30 miles out to the beach in the middle of the night, and then you get there and they give you the COVID vaccine. It was very weird in the 90s. Number eight. Gavin Newsom, our governor, is facing a recall. Gavin Newsom, former mayor of San Francisco, now governor of California, facing a recall. Gavin Newsom thinks that he's Christian Bale Batman and he's actually Val Kilmer Batman. You know what I'm saying? So before Gavin Newsom was in politics, he owned a wine bar in the marina for men who wore sweater vests. It was called Plump Jack, which is the term for ejaculating from a limp penis. And And if you're new to San Francisco, his history is there was in 2004 there was a big photo shoot. His first wife is Kimberly Guilfoyle, who is famous now as the crazy person who's banging Donald Trump Jr. And but his first wife is Kimberly Guilfoyle. And in 2004, there's a famous Harper's Bazaar photo shoot. I want you to take a minute. If you don't know the picture, look it up on your phone. Gavin Newsom, Harper's Bazaar. Oh wait.
It's amazing.
Okay. So I know. So it's a picture of them lying, spooning in a mansion on a fancy rug in a tuxedo and formal wear on the ground. So this is like such excessive rich people consciousness to lie down in your tux. Like if you are not a rich person, like you were raised correct. You know what I mean? Like your parents would be like, what the fuck are you doing lying on the ground in your one nice suit? You know what I mean? Like if you're lying down in a suit, that means you have multiple suits and you're an asshole. Like that's what's happening. Like their outfit, like it looked, the picture looks like the picture on a glossy brochure advertisement for guillotines. You know what I'm saying? Little killing the rich joke. But the recall campaign, my favorite thing about the recall campaign, is that it's being led by this weird crank political consultant with an eye patch, and his name is Randy Economy. And it's perfect. It's like, how on the nose is it that the Republican political operative targeting the governor because the pandemic has impeded commerce, his name is literally horny for capitalism. Do you know what I mean? Like his whole political team is like, you know, thirsty profit accumulation, domestic visible hand, Bill Cosby. You know what I'm saying? Anyway, fine. Okay, we can cut that one out. number nine. I have children. So for Emily, I'm the ghost of Christmas future. I have 12-year-old twins. I have 12-year-old twins. They go to public school. They're in seventh grade. They're doing homeschooling. It's incredibly stressful having kids at home, obviously. But they're in seventh grade. I'm glad they're home. Fuck that. If they were in school, they'd be at seventh grade with a bunch of 12-year-old boys calling stuff gay and dick punching each other all the time. Like, that's a good thing to miss, you know? Instead, they're at home writing essays about Frida Kahlo and discussing how every action movie is about institutional failure and untreated mental illness. And they're great. My kids are great. It blew their mind when they discovered that heterogeneous is a scientific term that refers to diverse biology and does not short for heterosexual genius. So that was a big thing. Like one of my kids identifies as non-binary and uses they/them pronouns. And so they've been getting into the whole history of queer culture. And so we're talking to them about the Stonewall riots and the history of the AIDS movement and about bathhouses and cruising and hanky codes. And then at some point they were like, excuse me, I'm 12, man, what I do? And you're talking about getting your dick sucked in the park? Like, what are you doing? Please stop. So, and then, but they're great. And so, like, we were, as a parent of a non-binary kid, I'm trying to be supportive. And I was like, hey, honey, you know, we know this other kid who's a little bit older than you, who's trans, and they go to a support group for queer and trans kids. And maybe you want to go to that group and find some community, get some support. And they're like, no, I don't want to go to that group. That kid is trans. They're still in the gender binary. I'm gender fluid. I'm not in the gender binary. What has that group got to do with me? And then I blacked out. because I'm of a different generation. Do you know what I mean? Like I'm of a in my generation, like people spent many years at UC Santa Cruz studying gender theory to get to that, like, they're in the gender binary, I don't know the gender binary, what is it? Like that was like some next level shit, you know what I mean? Like my kid is not, like this stuff is effortless to them. They're like in a lab on strike against the concept of gender, reinventing gender for the 21st century. And I'm like, what are you talking about? And they're like, Jed, just be quiet, make me a sandwich. You know what I mean? I'll see you later. Thanks everybody, good night.
Thank you, Nato. Before we close out the show, we thought it'd be fitting to create our own award celebrating the absolutely stupidest shit that happened in the past year, and there's a lot of it. To do this, we compiled footage and narrowed it down to the best Karens of the pandemic. Now, it's important to note that it hasn't just been women who've been acting a fool during this whole thing. We've got at least one Kyle in this roundup. But for the sake of brevity, we're just calling it the best COVID Karen Award. And it was really, really difficult, so we consulted the most highly respected carinologists from around the country. So that said, before we reveal the winner at the end, feel free to share your favorite Karen in the chat.
The nominees for Best Karen are...
And then put that, all the germs from your chin, back on your nose and mouth. How in the good Lord's name is that going to prevent the spread of germs and illness? It does not.
Democratic pigs, Karen.
Oh, look here. That man harassed me for not wearing a mask. I have a breathing problem. My doctor would not let me wear a mask. So anyone harassing me to wear a mask, you guys are violating federal law.
Finger pointing Karen.
Narrative. And when you wear a mask, which you can certainly do, you are further pushing the agenda that is condemning all of us.
Waited long enough,
Karen.
You
have that right, and I talked to my attorney before I came here, too. Okay. So does he want that to happen? I've waited long enough for my teeth to be cleaned, okay? Let's get this done.
Sheep calling Karen.
These sheep that are here, all wearing this mask, it's actually dangerous for them, and it's doing nothing for them. A 99% survival rate, and you're all wearing masks like sheep. Like sheep, seriously. It's ridiculous. You guys share this? This is what we're dealing with in America. This cannot be the new normal.
Violating rights, Kyle.
In violation of my fucking constitutional rights and my civil rights. I already fucking warned you. Fucking expect it. I'm filing a fucking class action lawsuit. You can take your fake fucking global terroristic false flag attack, shove it up your motherfucking ass. You're terrorists.
Finally, you're fucking Iron Legend.
What?
This is very funny.
I'm
go
dying.
Home.
Hello?
I went down the door right now.
You got Rona.
Yeah, that's more like Walking Dead, Karen. That is terrifying. I can't believe you have to deal with that shit. And finally, the winner of the Best COVID Care Award goes to... There's an award.
All right.
Well, that's the show. This was fantastic. Thank you all so much. I want to give a shout out. Let me run down the names of the comedians one more time, so that way we can Google them and follow them on all the social medias. Make some noise for Orion Levine. Dan Opitz. James Mora. Serenity Mira Sakara. Murad Shaki. Emily Van Dyke. Laura Green. Make some noise. And make some noise for Naked Kitchen for hosting us on this beautiful day. And finally, make some noise for you at home for supporting fucking people doing cool shit. You're wonderful. Yeah. Thank you very much. It's been lovely. Good night.
Sorry. Let's keep that in. He was stealing my titties, and let me do that from the top. This guy, he walked into my cafe, and he stole some tips out of the tip jar. Okay, and my coworker, she was like, if he's stealing tips. God damn it! All I'm thinking about is titties. One tip now? Okay, come on. Okay. Quite on set! I'm yelling that to myself. Okay, I remember so...
Wait, stand down. I'm sorry, I gotta edit this.
Can you stop? This is my dream!